girl.
Just bruise.
Hopefully, yeah.
Why they got so much steps?
No.
Did Mama finish eating her Pop Tart?
Why would you appear to me?
She was running around. She was running around outside. And but I'm just getting loose and loose and loose and loose. I had a little cute bun on the side of her bowl. I'm glad I didn't even get anxious with her. I'm really thinking, I'll make it tighter. Con el pinche, píntalo con el pinche, a ver.
Mami, let me just fix it. Let me fix it. Ay, que se quede así. Oh man, look, she her hair is so thin. Look what happens.
Which one, mommy?
Banana?
Banana.
You want some?
Banana.
I cannot find her muffin.
It's not like a toy. It's not like a toy.
Did you see her muffin?
Did you finish all of them?
Yeah, all we have to do is the box.
Yeah, send me pictures.
I'm gonna grab the well, you know, the eraser.
What? No.
It's the ape and the
nasty,
the elephant. Then remember what we printed out. I printed out and put it printed it out, put it on a construction. So the monkey with the eraser goes with that. And then the dogs, we just took a picture and wrote what we wrote in the back. So all of now those two things put it inside that box. We don't have to stuck it in the box or anything, so we're decorating.
But yeah, I see that when I'm in the shop right now, I was like,
mira que yo buscado, no lo encontré.
Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't get to go to shop.
She was squishing. No, just little ones, like,
ones that squish.
it. I'll just.
Here.
That's for banana.
Here.
Thank you. Hey, hey, man, how you doing?
It's so
I would have been there just now.
I just want to.
church. Happy Sabbath. One, two, that's better. Let's try that one more time, all right? Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I'm not convinced. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
There you go. Even if you fake it, just do it so that I can feel better. Right? Can you guys stand with me so we can all come with the word of prayer? Let us pray. Father in heaven, once again, we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you everything that we have, we give you 100%, Father, because you deserve nothing less, Father. And we come to worship you, Father, our needs are second behind your gratitude, Father. We're so thankful for everything that you've done for us. We're thankful for the fact that we're alive, that we're breathing. We're thankful that we have the opportunity to fall on our knees. With that being said, we're going to collect our children offering just like normal, just like we always do every week. Someone asked them to help me out in the back, and they'll play the children's offering. We don't have a children's story this morning, I'm sorry. A lot of the leadership is away, and so it's just me, and I can't do everything, so I apologize for that. So if they can help me out in the back, we'll have them come forward and collect the offering. Then after that, we'll have a special prayer for our tithes and offerings, and we'll go ahead and collect that. Come on, kids. There you go. My daughter needed the charge.
I lay my life down at your feet. Your
right, guys, now's the time for our tithes and offerings. I think we got the cup holder change out of the way, right? I heard a lot of change jiggling as the kids were collecting their tithes and offerings. It's okay, I don't want to guilt you, but it's time to give God what he really deserves, everything that we've got. And that goes, that's also the truth in our tithes and our offerings, being faithful to him and everything that we have. So, you got the ching-ching out of the way, you got all the cup holder money out of the way. I think someone's going to help you out in the back, and we're going to collect our tithes and our offerings, and hopefully there's something that doesn't mean always. Father in heaven, we thank you for what we have, Father. We thank you for what we need that you have fulfilled in our lives. We thank you for the finances that you've provided for us, Father. Whatever it is that we have in our pockets, left over, Father, we know that you've blessed, Father. And it will suffice, and you will take care of our needs, because you ask us to trust you daily, Father. So here we are, Father, testing you in our tithes and our offerings, testing you faithfulness daily, leaning on you, knowing full heartedly that you will come through and you will provide. Father, we ask that these tithes and these offerings, Father, can sincerely, Father, go into ministry, and that somebody can be blessed, touched, transformed, and saved because of our faithfulness. We thank you, we love you, in the precious name of Jesus.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath. Please say welcome to the person who is next to you. Say welcome. Welcome to.
Let me go over there here. Okay, welcome. But everybody, share a good welcome, okay? Because we don't see it from last Sabbath. And it's a very, very, very good opportunity together today to praise the Lord.
I have one question. How many people understand Spanish here? How many people are understanding Spanish? A lot, no? Okay. So, si hablan español, está bien? Okay, maybe yes, maybe no. But, you know, I trust in the Lord who filled the tongue of Moses. So, it's the same Lord that I trust today. And I know you and me, we can join in to worship our Lord. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible say in Psalms 92, it's a special song from the Sabbath. It's a beautiful songs. I want to read to you the first verse says, "It is good to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your loving kindness in the morning and your faithfulness every night." on an instrument of 10 strings, on the lute, and on the harp with harmonious sound. For you, Lord, have made me glad through your work. I will triumph in the works of your hands. So praise the Lord. We want to sing some songs this morning. Please, we can together praise to our God. So, my good friend Ben, you can help me with the song, My Jesus, My Savior. My Jesus, My Savior. Jesus is our Savior, our Lord. So we can praise Him.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is no like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. Tower of refuge, yeah.
and we sing another song. Lead me to Calvary. Lead me to Calvary.
King of my life, I crown you now. Yours will the glory be. Lest I forget your thorny crown. Lead me to Calvary. Show me the tomb where you were laid, tenderly mourned and mad. Angels in robes of light arrayed, wandered in wondrous land. So I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let me like Mary through the womb, come with a gift for you. Show me now the empty tomb, all that you said was true. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me. Lead me to Calvary. May I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for you. Even your cup of grief to share, even be a heart renewed. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me, lead me to Calvary. Forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me, lead me to Calvary. Into Calvary.
Amen. Yeah, we sing a last song. How great is our God? Is our last song? How great is our God?
Same religion.
Scripture is in 2 Kings chapter 3. If you have your Bible, you can open it. 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 9. 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 9. So the king of Israel went with the king of Judah and the king of Edom, and they marched on the round about road 7 days, and there was no water for the army, nor for the animals that followed them. I invite you to go, please, with our needs and pray to our Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to be here, in this church today. But thank you, Lord, because if your Sabbath is a special day, and we are here before you because we need you. We need you because you are our Savior, our guidance, our Lord, our hope, our strength. So So we are here before you. And I know, God, you have a plan for us. And you want to reveal this plan to us today through your word. Bless every soul in this temple today. Bless every friend that came today to this church. Every kid, every youth. And Lord, allow us, when we're done here today, we go out with a different spirit for help every person near to us and show the love that we learn here today. Receive our prayers. Receive our questions. We trust in you. And I know, God, you never, never run away from us. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, before the pastor team, I want to sing with you one more song. It's an old song. And I hope this song turns to your prayer in your heart today. So, my good friend, are you ready? I invite you to sing with me if you want.
Me up so I can spend.
How many knew Gabriel Montalvo? Only about half the church. Okay. So that's good that the church has been growing and vibrant and alive. Let me share with you a little history. Gabriel and I became very close friends. Ben, I'm gonna need you in just a minute, so just prepare to come on up front here. Gabe and I began our friendship when I came. He was pastor of this church and several other churches. Shortly after he came, Elder Juan Lopez retired. I asked that Gabriel would take the place of Hispanic coordinator because Gabriel had a heart for the Lord. He was a good leader. When Gabriel died, at the funeral, I told Elder Ray Hartwell, I can't do anything for this service. I'll just break down. I'll just cry. Because we were so close. That's where this church falls in my heart. Gabriel told Anna and me before he died, this relationship that I, Tim, had with him was the closest spiritual relationship of any leadership ever in this conference. That's how I come here today, with an understanding of Gabriel's vision for this church. We talked often. We talked daily. We talked about this church. We talked why it was formed. What's the foundation of this church? I asked Elder Ray Hartwell to ask for a raising of the hands
of how many people in that congregation at the Boulevard were baptized by Gabriel. Over 1,000 people came to that funeral. 300-400 people raised their hands that he baptized them. 8 churches were planted in Philadelphia through the ministry of Pastor Gabriel Montalvo. I wanted to share with you that he and I were brothers. And I understand the foundation and the beginning of this church. As it started in his home, as a small group, formed into a company, finally with a building and a facility, prepared and ready to bring new membership in, as some of you are. Some of you may not know all of that history, but I want to share with you that today I want to seek God's will. And Ben, I got to get you up here for prayer. Ben, you were part of that initial group. You and your brother, a few others, started off. And were you the first two? No, but you were part of that first group. I want to pray for you today. And I'm going to specifically ask in the name of Jesus for something special to happen here. I'm going to ask for clarity for God's will. Amen. I'm going to ask for our hearts to change if we need to change. That can go many ways. That can be decisions that we're making. That can be lethargy for full commitment to Jesus. That can be all the things that you can imagine and it can be. But I am going to claim in the name of Jesus here today that we will know his will from his word. Can we hear an amen for that? Amen. Now I want to welcome those that may be watching in Dominican Republic right now. I'm hoping there's someone in Lancaster County watching right now. I pray that those, maybe as Elson has any reception whatsoever while he's off with family vacation, that he can see right now. But I want to know that by God's grace, he speaks to us. Can we say amen in agreements to that here today?
Amen.
So, Ben, I'm going to place my hand upon your shoulder. I saw you struggling a little bit in the beginning of the service because that means that there's decisions that you're in the valley of, that you're making decisions on. You may be right, you may be wrong, you may be crazy. But God's looking for people that will serve him with all their heart and they're willing to do whatever he asks them to do. Sometimes we're right, sometimes we're wrong. God will bless us in spite of ourselves. That's what he's done for my life. How about yours? And so I'm going to ask that God make it very clear today what God wants for each one of us to do. Let's pray. Dear Father, I want to pray for Ben. I want to pray for this church. I want to pray for the transitions, the things that we're looking at, the future of PYC. And we pray for your will. In Jesus' name, amen. One thing I'm known for in our conference here is being honest. No matter what, even if it hurts. I want to be so brutally honest in whatever questions you may ask, whatever we may do. I want to be honest and true to my God and my Savior. Amen? If we can't do that, then we have no place in his work. I want to invite you, if you're a sermon Bible follower, I want you to open up your Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 3. And that's the only place that we're going to be here this morning. And I want to go through Scripture. And I'm going to ask, I've already asked, that God would speak to our hearts no matter what. And I'm going to ask that you be willing to listen to God's word and how he speaks to you individually. Then at the end of this message, I want to pass out some handbooks here. And I want to discuss about the future of PYC and the Pennsylvania Conference and entire mission that we have together. I want to make a statement that everything will flow off of and the foundation of the entire scriptural message today. Empty channels full of faith will become fountains of blessings. I want to just tell you right now, those empty channels are you and I. We have nothing without Jesus. Men can live almost 40 days without food, but you can only live about 3 days without water. My father died a year ago on Father's Day during camp meeting. And he was no longer eating and drinking, and he asked me how long it would take for him to pass away. And I was confident that 3 or 4 days is all that any one of us can last without water. I want to tell you that's true with spirituality too. The water of life, which is Jesus. You can only last a few days. You can go without eating or having a morning devotional, which is the bread of life. But you can only go a few days without spiritually collapsing, without praying and at least talking to the Lord, receiving the Spirit, the water of life. I had a friend in my first district. He would pray before he even drank water. I said, John, why do you do that? Kind of crazy, isn't it? I mean, we pray before we eat. I even do that in a restaurant. How about you? Do you have enough spiritual boldness to pray in front of people?
I do.
Good, I do too. But he would pray before he even drank the water. John, why? He said, water is even, if it could be stated, more important than even food. Our whole bodies are made up of water. So often we take it for granted. There's people in other parts of the world that do all kind of things to get their water. One group in the Persian Gulf, they dive down in the ocean to a spring and they open up a bag, a goatskin bag, and they get their water that way through the jet stream coming out of the salt, briny water. It's amazing what people will do. It's with the same kind of need for water that we come to our story. Have you ever been really thirsty? I've been really thirsty before. I work and I sweat. You think it's raining, but no, it's not. It's just me sweating because I sweat so much and I get thirsty. I can drink a gallon of water in a day. As a result, I know what it means to be really thirsty physically. I want to tell you, we need to have that same kind of thirst for God's Spirit, for his indwelling in our life. We need to say at that same time the hunger and thirst for knowing God's will. What is God's will for PYC? What is God's will for this community? But I want to tell you that we are bigger than South Philly. I want to tell you that right now, a Seventh-day Adventist. The Seventh-day Adventist Church preaches the three angels' message, and we're a worldwide movement that goes around the entire globe because we're not just a single congregation. We're part of a movement, a giant army, a group of people that are involved in spreading the gospel to everyone, everywhere. Not just a neighborhood. We're way bigger than that. I, as a Seventh-day Adventist, you, as a Seventh-day Adventist, are part of a worldwide movement that shares the gospel of the soon return of Jesus Christ. And in this story, we see that three kings, in 2 Kings here, we see three kings, they're going to war because things are not going right within their company, within their system, within their group. And there's supposed to be all of this taxation. They're getting involved in this battle, in this war, over some money and some territory. You ever seen churches do that before? Everything doesn't go the way they want it. They don't think everything's following through the way they think it should be. And therefore, they go to war. and they're going to war, and they decide that they're going to make a plan. Now, Israel, in this situation, moves rather hastily without thinking things through properly. They realize that if they're going to make battle on this group, that they either go cross the river and head on, but the enemy will see them, or they go through the desert and they try to make a surprise attack. And for this thirsty experience, we find in 2 Kings chapter 3, we see Judah, Israel, and Edom, the three kingdoms, going to attack the Moabites. But there's poor planning. And they end up very thirsty, for lack of planning. Now, there's only these two possibilities: head-on frontal attack or sneak attack. And they chose the sneak attack. And so we read this story in verse 9. 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 9. Look what it says. So the king of Israel went, and the king of Judah, and the king of Edom, and they marched on the roundabout route 7 days, but there was no water for the army, or the animals, or anybody that followed them. Isn't that the way it is sometimes with us in church? We get thoroughly organized. Yep. We get equipped with all the things we need. By the way, I love these new chairs. This is a great addition to PYC. Only thing, I'm a little shocked. I'm used to seeing a lot of instruments. I don't know where they are today. Maybe they're camping or something. But I miss seeing the whole church here today. Maybe it's for construction. I don't know what it has been. But I know that we get equipped with every seminar that's available. I know our leadership team has gone to training. And we've had board meetings. We've had nominating committees. We've had subcommittees, and sometimes there's even self-appointed committees when they're not supposed to be. But we're here. Through all of that, God has given us this beautiful facility in spite of ourselves. Can we say amen to that? It's a beautiful facility in spite of all of its weaknesses and all of its needs. But this king, these three united kings against Moabite, found themselves utterly helpless. Things didn't turn out the way they wanted, the way they planned. You see, they had a grandiose plan of changing the course of history, how things were going. But perhaps it's because the refreshing stream of God's power was not with them. Perhaps they started out to battle without double-checking upon God to make sure that they were following His way. Remember, if you run ahead of God, you meet the enemy alone. Did you hear what I said there? If you run ahead of God, you're on your own. Well, back to the story. We find these thirsty thousands not knowing what to do. Look at verses 11 through 14. And Jehoshaphat said, "Is there no prophet of the Lord here, that I may inquire of the Lord by him?" So one of the servants of the king of Israel answered and said, "Elisha, the son of Shaphat, is here, who poured water on the hands of Elisha." Today I'd like to just compare myself to this individual, because Gabriel was the founder. He's the one that gets all the credit humanly. And I am only the one who helped wash his hands. I don't have any credit for what God has done through him and you in this church. I want to share with you that God has chosen me to be the leader of Israel in this portion of the territory of Pennsylvania right now. And I speak for him. through God's holy word. I may not have any of the credentials that Gabriel had, but I know the man who knew the man. And verse 12, and Jehoshaphat said, the word of the Lord is with him. So the king of Israel, Jehoshaphat, and the king of Edom went down to him. And Elisha said to the king of Israel, what have I to do with you? Go to the prophets of your father and the prophets of your mother. But the king of Israel said to him, no, the Lord has called thee three kings together to deliver into the hands of Moab. And Elisha says, the Lord of hosts lives before whom I stand. Surely we're not. Were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not even look at you. I want to tell you, sometimes we make mistakes in life. But I want to tell you, if it wasn't for the Lord, if it wasn't for Jesus, you wouldn't want to look at me, and I wouldn't want to look at you either. And that's okay. Because my Lord has paid it all, and we can accept each other just like he accepts us in spite of ourselves. Well, the lowly servant came forward. He said, I know a man. I know a man of God. It didn't matter the position in life he had, great or small. It was only the connection that he had with his Lord that mattered here. How true it is with you and I. I don't care what problems you're going through life. I mean, I do. But follow what I'm trying to say. If you have a connection with Jesus, it's all going to be okay. Even if you die. Even if you go through trials. Even if you're suffering. It's all okay. Because this earth is only a temporary place. You see, I actually do really believe in a kingdom of heaven. Amen. I believe that someday soon Jesus will come again. Do you believe that?
Amen.
I believe in him. And I need all these things. Revelation 3:19 tells us very clearly, right? Revelation 3:20 says, behold, I knock. He wants in our heart. But Revelation 3:19 says that he gives us afflictions and trials and does all the thing to get our attention so that when he knocks, we'll listen. No matter what position we're in life, no matter how great or small, it's the connection that we have with God that matters. How true it is with you and I. I want to tell you how much I love this church. You say you don't see me very often, but you have to understand in 3 years, this is my 8th time here. I preached here, this is my 3rd time preaching. I chose this to be the very first church I was at with Faith for Family. I want to tell you what happened that day. There was huge storms. The whole place was supposed to be totally enveloped with water. And I have a picture still on my phone of the radar where the rain was around the entire city of Philadelphia, and inside where we were going door to door that day was completely dry into the minute that we finished. You say 8 times in 3 years, that's not very much. I oversee 130 churches. It takes me 3 years, if I'm faithful and going to only one church at a time, to see all 130 churches. But I've been at PYC 8 times because I have a love for this congregation. I have a love for the memory of Gabriel and what he has done to establish this as a plan to get it to the place where it is right now. How true it is with you and I. We may not be a pastor. We may not have a title. We may not even be an officer. Some of us here may not even be members yet of PYC. But it's not all that what matters. It's who you know. I want to ask you a very serious question here this morning. Do you know Jesus?
Yes.
Jesus is the reason that we're here. Do you know Jesus really well enough to recommend him in any crisis, in any trial? You want to reach the community? Reach them when they're in need. Reach them when they're hurting. Reach them when they have a problem. Point them to the foot of the cross. Tell them about Jesus, and things will change in their lives and they'll change in yours. You have to be so close to him that you have confidence to automatically turn to Jesus when every single thing goes wrong.
Amen.
I have to tell you, I don't always do that. So don't be discouraged. Because it's not the occasional deed or misdeed or the mistake here and there, but it's the general direction of our lives that makes the difference. When someone seeks your help, do you give them the advice of the world, or do you point them to Jesus and Jesus only? Well, these men turn to the prophet because they know that he's the type of person that depends upon Jesus. But the prophet makes a strange demand. I'm going to make that same demand today. Pablo, at the end of this sermon, Ben, I want you to have his second song queued up so it's very organized and ready at the end of this time. But in verse 15, here's what he says. But now bring me the musician. And it happened. And when the musician played, the hand of the Lord came upon him. I want to tell you that I have no idea what song Pablo is going to choose here at the end. Doesn't matter, it's not going to be instantly. I still have a few more things I want to share with you. But he says, bring me a musician. I want to tell you why he asked for a musician. That's why I'm so disappointed I didn't have the whole group here, all the musicians and all the things going that we normally had. I understand there's a wedding in DR. By the way, how many here are from DR originally? Anybody? Oh, a couple of you. I held a couple evangelistic series in DR, had some great time. I held the last one was at the Lighthouse Church. We had a huge response. We're preaching in a church this size. They'd never had a really good, strong meeting. And I asked the same kind of prayer that I prayed at the beginning of this service. I demanded the Lord's blessings upon that house. And I told them by faith that we're going to have so many people come to this meeting that every chair is going to be filled. You're going to have to bring new chairs in and fill them out in the back. And then people are going to stand at the windows. The pastor laughed and said, that never happens here. I want to tell you, at the end of those meetings, we had to rent more chairs. People were standing, hundreds of people outside those windows looking in. And we had one of the largest baptisms that church had ever seen. We helped them drill a new well. They fixed their baptistry. And to God be the glory, we had a beautiful baptism at the end. Baptisms are the sealing of the faith in people coming to Jesus. So Elijah, he said, bring the musicians together because they're very important for worship. And the Spirit of the Lord has not come upon me because I'm not ready yet. The musicians began to play, Pablo. Not yet. I did the musician. I got him on the edge of his seat now. He's ready. He's biting at the bit to serve the Lord. But they were singing. And then finally, Elisha, follow me now, stood up, began going like this, and he began shouting, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. The Spirit of the Lord is now upon me. I'm ready to serve him. I'm ready to be the mouthpiece for the Lord. Look at me in verses 16, 17, and 18. And the Lord said, thus the valley shall you make full of ditches. What did I say? Full of what? Come on now. What did I just say? Potholes or ditches? Thank you. Potholes might have worked too. But thus said the Lord, you shall not see wind, nor shall you see rain, yet the valley shall be filled with water. what shall it be filled with?
Water.
So that you and your cattle and your animals may you drink. Now look at verse 18. I love this verse. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me and He's upon you as we hear His word. And this is a simple matter in the sight of the Lord. And He will deliver the Moabites to you. The foundation and the beginning of this church is to deliver the sinners up unto Jesus so that they can be saved and they can worship Him. That's the foundation of this church. Amen? We want to fill this church with broken people so that they can be filled with the Spirit of the Lord. Well, when I was in college, yes, they had colleges way back then. I was in college. It was my first day working on a construction crew. And the guy's name was Schoonard. Isn't that a weird name? I thought it was a weird name. Short little guy, old guy, always had his tool belt on. He was the boss, Earl Schoonard. And I went there, and I remember my father told me, whenever you go to work, if you're paid, it doesn't matter if you're doing foolishness or you're accomplished, whatever the boss tells you, that's what you're supposed to do. You're getting paid to do it. So he handed me a shovel, and he showed me this big mound of gravel about twice the size of this drum booth. And he said, the dump truck put the gravel in the wrong spot. It should be over there on the other side, about 10 feet away. And he handed me the shovel, and he drove off on the pickup truck. I don't know how that make you feel, but I looked at that pile of gravel and I said, why didn't he just get the backhoe and scoot it over there? And those words came in my mind. Whatever your hand finds to do, do with all your might. Your father told you to do what you're told. You're being paid. It doesn't matter what you do. And I began to shovel. Four hours later, it was lunchtime. I sit down and have my lunch. Back to it. Never saw Earl the whole day. 5 minutes before quitting time, he drove up. He said, you're almost done. I'm thinking he's going to say, just leave the rest. He said, tomorrow morning, get back to it. I could not believe him. Yes, sir. I went home. Came back the next morning, I put my work gloves on, and he pulled up in the pickup truck. He said, hey, Tim, come over here. I came over, and he said, hop in the truck. I hopped in the truck, we began to drive off. He said, I have to go to town, I have to buy some things, I want you to go with me. Then he began to explain. He said, you know, that was a waste of your time to shovel all that gravel. I said, yes, sir, I know that. Why didn't you get a backhoe, which we have right there, taking about 10 minutes? He said, because it was a test for you. I wanted to see if you could follow directions and you could stick to the course and you could follow through with what you were asked to do. God's asked this church to do some very important things, and that's reach the world with the gospel. Are you sticking to course? So what he did was, after that Pablo, we went to town, we got back, and he pulled out these things called blueprints on the hood of the truck. And he began to teach me how to read blueprints. He taught me how to run a backhoe. He taught me how to run a transit so that you can lay a ditch for a septic system. He taught me how to wire a house. He taught me how to plumb a house. He taught me how to be the foreman. From that day on, I became the assistant foreman for the crew. And it's because I was faithful in the little things. Digging ditches is very humble work. I want to tell you what, there's a lot of humble work left to do here at PYC. I want to make it very plain to you. We're not where we need to be yet. There's still so many things. Most people quit right before success is just around the corner. We're not done with PYC yet. God has not developed PYC into what it needs to be done. And digging ditches is a very humble, hard work. We cannot quit digging the ditches that God has asked us to do for this community, for God's Seventh-day Adventist Church, which I believe with all my heart is God's remnant movement for the last days. Amen. So God saw in their digging some faithful funnels that he planned on sending water to. I'm going to tell you, there is so much blessing just to come around the corner when all of these ditches are dug right here at PYC. Luke 6:38 says that if you'll give of yourselves, God will give blessings back to you. Just to show you how much, he says, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over and overflowing. PYC's great days are yet to come. We have only just begun digging the ditches. But the blessings of the three kings haven't stopped yet. Look at verse 21. Well, let me come back before I go there. Here's what happens. Look at verse 20. And now it happened in the morning. What time of the day?
Morning.
In the morning. That the grain offering was being given. Let me just explain this to you in very simple terms. They got up for morning worship. Have you ever heard of that before? Morning worship? Where we get up to pray. And suddenly, water came by way of Edom. Let me tell you that the way of Edom is desert. Water does not come out of desert. Water comes out of green, lush territory. But in this situation, the Israelites were having their morning worship. And water came. What's the problem that was going on in this story? They didn't have water. Now verse 21. And when all the Moabites heard this, they came up to fight. Let me share with you, I'll put it in my own words, the next three verses. The Israelites got up for morning worship. The day before, they dug ditches. Hard, humble work. They had their morning worship and they crawled out of their tents. And out of Edom came water. Let me tell you, that's a rich blessing because they were about ready to die. This church is on the verge that it could die. We don't already have anybody here. Last time I was here, it was packed. Packed. Standing room. But they had their morning worship and they crawled out of their tents. And they looked. And God had blessed their efforts. And if you're thirsty, what do you do? I'm going to tell you what you do. I'm going to give you an example. Watch it. Right here. They began to drink. Feel so much better. I was so thirsty. I was losing energy. And they drank their water. And this new life came into them. They began to jump for joy. They were high-fiving each other. They were hugging each other. They were crawling around on the ground, laughing and joking and shouting and saying, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, for the water that came after their commitment time, their morning devotional time. And the Moabites saw them from the hill. They had stayed up all night. And they're about ready to make battle and war. And they see them down there as the sun was just coming up. It's right here in Scripture, these few verses. The sun was just beginning to come up. They were waiting for that time. And they see the Israelites. They're shouting. They're rolling around. They're high-fiving, but it's a far way off, and the sun is just coming up. And they look, and all those ditches are shining red from the glare of the morning sun. And they say to themselves, look, the Israelites have drawn their swords. They're fighting each other. They're killing each other from the madness of the lack of water. And so the Moabites yell and shout, Moab to the spoil. And they begin running down the hill. And they'd stayed up all night long. They're tired. They're thirsty. They're exhausted. And then they run that mile or more down the hill, shouting, and Moab to the spoil, with their swords and their shields, and they're jumping the boulders and the rock, and they land finally down at the bottom of the hill where the spiritual warfare has begun, and the Israelites have just been filled with the Spirit from their morning devotional. They've been filled with the physical water. They've been filled with the water of life, and they stand up, and they take their swords, and Scripture says they destroy the enemy from end to the beginning. Done. Victory, God says, is mine. God has called us to be diggers. It's hard work. But when we do, patriarchs, prophets, and kings says, when in faith we take hold of his strength, he will change, wonderfully change, the most hopeless, discouraging outlook. He will do this for the glory of his name. Isn't your soul thirsting for the presence of God? Come on now. Amen? So I want to tell PYC, dig deep into the Word of God. Dig into your own heart for commitment and service and mission. We need to stop procrastinating doing the things that the Holy Spirit's been telling us to do. Whatever that is. Spend that quiet time with God in the morning. Dig deep, so deep that you'll find all those broken palaces pushed aside. Dig into the depths of our soul that God may fill us with his love and his blessings, so that he may quench the thirsting that we've been feeling. Are you thirsty yet here this morning? It's time to pray for God's leading. Are you tired of filling the emptiness with other things? I want to tell you, the emptiness that you felt recently is the void of Jesus in your heart. The emptiness of unfulfilled dreams is the void of Jesus in our hearts. We need to completely be satisfied with the truth of Jesus in our hearts. Because without that living water, we have nothing. So we need to dig deep into his word daily. We need to believe that he started a good work and he's going to finish it. He's going to perfect it. Remember the opening sentence that I gave to you. Empty channels full of faith will become fountains of blessings. Pablo, I want you to hand me one of these white booklets here, and I want you to give one to everybody else. I want to share with you about the possibilities that this church has. You see, we've started as a Pennsylvania Conference a mission strategy for the next 5 years. We started in 2018 and go to 2023. And the main thing is to reach everyone everywhere. And I want to tell you that one of the strategic goals that we have is unity. The North American division has a baptismal growth rate of 2.3% of its membership each year. I want to tell you that the Pennsylvania Conference last year had a 6% growth rate. That's over double. I want to tell you why, because God is really blessing and pouring his heart out upon our conference and each one of us. And one of the reasons is because we believe in total member involvement. We believe in you. And we have some of the things it talks in here, how to fulfill the mission. But I want to take this first quote right here by this church in this purple page as you open it up. It says, the church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world. You see, the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a very unique system. We're not congregationalists. We're a worldwide movement. I've preached all over the world. I've been to 39 countries, and I've preached in many different countries around the world. I've held evangelistic series, United all over in the United States in different places. And I've been with pastors from all over the world. And there's one unique thing about Seventh-day Adventist pastors. Whether you live in India, Ukraine, Puerto Rico, DR, or Philadelphia, we all get paid the same. How does that work? Well, it's because we're one united church. You see, we take the standard of living, middle class, lower and middle class, and we make sure that every pastor around the world gets paid for that. If you're Indian, that'll be about $65 a month. NDR, it's a little bit different. In Puerto Rico, it's a little bit different. In the U.S., it's a little bit different. In fact, the pastors that are in Philadelphia get paid a little bit more than I get paid in Reading, because it's not about how much we get paid, but can we have the same standard of living? That's because we're a worldwide movement. You see, the three angels' messages is to go ye into all the world. That's why our message here is reaching everyone everywhere. Our goal is not just to reach Hispanics or English, which has been pretty much the mission of the Pennsylvania Conference in the past. Our goal is to reach the Korean, the low class, the upper class, the Ukrainian, the Russian, everyone. So we have a strategic initiative of reaching every single demographic within the conference. We're trying to be honest and fair to put the efforts and the resources into every single demographic that is available. The Chinese deserve the opportunity of the gospel just as much as the Spanish do. That's not dissing Spanish. But God loves red and yellow, black and white, because all are precious in his sight. And we have an obligation to reach everyone. Not just West Philly, South Philly, not just Reading, but every single territory and every single people within the conference. And so our goal is to reach with the majority of the members praying for the outpouring of the Spirit. It's under go and grow here. Plant 13 new churches, lead 700 new people annually. We've already reached half of these goals in the first 2 years, and I want to tell you why. It's because we're attempting to be faithful to God in all of these things. To increase net membership, 13 million tithe annually. We were at 10 million 2 years ago. God has already given us this amount of tithe because of our faithfulness. This year, in our evangelism offering at the camp meeting, at the English camp meeting, we raised $280,000 for evangelism. Can you say amen to that? That's a beautiful thing. Because 4 years ago, the highest we had ever raised was $32,000. Ever. Each year is going up. I want to tell you why. Because our people, our church members, have confidence in what's happening here in Pennsylvania Conference. Church attendance is going up. We had one church in the northern tier of our conference who had not held an evangelistic series. Listen to this. They had not held an evangelistic series in 30 years. Can you imagine that? That's sad, isn't it? And they were an English congregation. They were going down, down, down in attendance. They had 150 30 years ago. They're down to 12 to 15 people. You want to know why? Because they were focused on themselves. They were focused on the community. Faith for Family went to that region last 2 years ago. And they decided to do the evangelism, go through the process in spite of all the kicking and screaming. They decided to give their hearts 100% to the process. They dug their ditches. And guess what happened? Their first evangelistic series in 30 years, they baptized 17 new people. They over doubled the attendance in their church. That's happened time and time and time again. So God is asking each one of us to join the movement. You see, the Pennsylvania Conference is a very small portion of the world church. You see, I'm involved in something bigger than a ministry. Faith for Family is going to have over 3,000 people come to the southeast region this year. We have over 3,000 people signed up to participate in Faith for Family. That's a big deal, isn't it? But I want to tell you, that's not what matters. What matters is that God's movement, His church, is moving together in one big, swift movement. And we're trying to reach everyone everywhere. Not just in Philly. Not just in Pennsylvania. Not just in the United States. But the entire world. Church is united together. So we have all these strategic plans: prayer, faith for family, planting churches, rejuvenating churches, our children, reaching and connecting. I want to talk to you about reaching and connecting. I want to tell you I'm so excited about this. You know, we would normally, on all of our faith for family times, we go to door, we may get 300-400 Bible study interest for our Bible workers in the region. Let me tell you, this year we're connecting social media with hard work and door-to-door. You guys are going to like this. If you guys are the techies of the church. We have a web page. We're advertising on Facebook. We have a landing page. Then we have a sign up. And we're advertising the territories before we go out door to door on Facebook, so people sees God cares for you. That's our door hanger this year. God cares for you. And already 400 people have signed up for Bible studies in the Philadelphia region around our churches. Amen. 2 weeks ago, I don't know, did anybody go to the youth rally from this church? Anybody was able to go? We had about 200 young people. Unfortunately, there weren't many from the Spanish or this church, it looks like. They were mostly the English churches, which is, that's not everyone everywhere. It evidently didn't get promoted well in some of our churches. We should have had about 600. With all the Spanish young people and everything. But I went, Pablo was there. I saw you there. Hey, thanks for supporting our youth trip. It's good, wasn't it? We had the NAD, one of the NAD youth directors. We had a wonderful time. And They went out door to door during that time. Over 60 Bible study interests came. When we go Faith for Family on September 12th this year with the Facebook advertising, we're looking at 1,000 to 2,000 interests coming in. God is blessing His people. We need to be prepared for the soon return of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So, Pablo, I want to ask you to sing a closing song. And then I'm going to have a prayer afterwards. But I just want to leave you here with this just before we pray. God's not done with PYC yet. Can you raise your hand in agreement with that? Amen. God's not done with you and I yet. Can you agree with that? We need to do some humble work. We need to dig some ditches. I want to share with you. Your conference has been very faithful in some things. And I have a copy of the check here for purchasing of the church and all the renovations that you asked for. Take some time. Carlos was on vacation here 2 weeks ago when it came in. We need to make decisions where we're headed. And you know what? God sometimes helps us when we're not making good decisions. We don't know where we're really heading. And right now, if we're not united together, we need to rethink things, how we're going to do things. But I want to tell you that's stepping out in faith. It's above and beyond what normally would happen. I want to tell you why we want to support this church. Because the foundation that it had from the beginning with Pastor Gabriel Montalvo. As for me, I want to serve the church and I want to help this church grow. And so I'm going to ask you to really take that seriously as we move forward. Pablo, I want you to sing for us and then I'm going to have to close in prayer.
Okay, you can stand up for Sing Togethers. Oh,
It's such my desire. I wish I could be here every week and help you with all processes and the growth and the planning. But as I said, there's 129 other churches that I work with. But God will make the way. All we have to do is listen to Him. Let me tell you, there's never a time that we can't change where we're heading and going, spiritually or physically. I can only be here a little bit of time. Well, I want to be just so blunt and so full and so clear that God wants to grow this church. God wants to fulfill a dream and mission for using you for reaching everyone everywhere. And you're only a small part. I'm only a small part. I'm only one person. In fact, if I get out of the equation, God will raise up someone else, and I'm insignificant. It doesn't really matter. Only thing that matters is that God's will is done. The only thing that matters is that you and I serve Him. The only thing that matters is that all the people within our sphere, within our realm, are united together for the cause and purpose of reaching everyone everywhere with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Very, very happy to be a part of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I want to close with this story. I want to share this with you. Pablo, you were a Bible worker before for us here in this conference. We had a very good Bible worker before you ever came. You don't know him. I'm going to say his name publicly. His name was Horace. And he was doing a great job. I can say this publicly because he's done some things publicly that are not good. And I need to be very clear about them. He was in one of our churches and he ended up making a mistake. And he had a relationship with a Bible study person that he shouldn't have. She was single, he was single. The night before her baptism, and he told her that it'd be okay because God would wash away her sins in the baptismal tank. She was crying. She felt guilty. It's a shame. It's a horrible thing. It's the only person I've ever fired in this conference. When I found out what happened, I was faithful to Jesus. I did what was right. I fired him on the spot. I drove all the way, 10-hour round trip, to take care of that. And I said to him, the only thing I want you to do, people make mistakes, I have to fire you. Please don't do any work in Pennsylvania. Because as long as you give time to let this situation get better, then God can use you still in the future. The reason why I make it public is because he went public and he started his own church 3 miles from the church. And he joined a group called Free Seventh-day Adventists. They're not Seventh-day Adventists, a different denomination. It's illegal to use the name Seventh-day Adventist or anything associated with it. And so the General Conference is suing him now. And they're going to shut down his ministry and things that's happening. And I went, and there were a group of people in his congregation who thought they were Seventh-day Adventists, but they weren't. When I made it very clear that you've joined another denomination, they were shocked. They were misled because they were no longer a part of God's large group, the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, there's a lot of independent ministries that support the church, and they're very healthy, and they're very acceptable. They're part of a group called ASI. That's Adventist Service International. That's a very healthy thing when we have independent groups that are part of God's church. They can be inside of a church. They can run within a church, but they don't have to be independent. And the thing about it is that this group, they didn't realize where they're going. They didn't ask for all the legal help. They didn't work within the structure, and they became independent, and it hurt Horace very much. Horace no longer serves the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I've had some situations. A good friend of mine, Kevin Hayden, he used to be a campaign speaker. He went all over the world speaking. He had the best-selling book in the 90s called The Shaking. And one day we were out traveling together, and he was eating, and he was putting gravy on his toast at the restaurant, at the bar. We went to a breakfast bar. I said, Kevin, there's pork in that. And he said, oh, that doesn't matter. Whatever you pray with, God bless us. I said, well, you know, God accepts us where they are, right? But then he began to doubt the Sabbath. Then he began to doubt Illinois. Now he's a Baptist elder in Georgia. He's no longer a part of God's church. We have to be very careful on where we move and how we do things. And God has given an organization with counsel and with help for all of us. And whenever we move, we need to move with wisdom and asking for God's blessings as we move forward. I want to have a word of prayer as we close, and I just want to say that God's not done with PYC yet. There's so much more to be done. There's so much more ministry. There's so more, many people that need to hear the gospel, the good news about Jesus' soon return. And I'm praying that we can unite together and accomplish those ministry things together. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, I want to ask in the name of Jesus that you bless us and keep us. There's so many things that we're thinking about. We don't have a lot of time together always, but this is the church. This is the Sabbath. This is the day that you've chosen. This is the handful of people that are here to hear. We just pray for your will to be done. We just pray for your blessings upon this congregation and all that we do and all that we say. Dear Lord, help us to humble ourselves in your sight and to be willing to do what you ask us to do. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. And you want to say something? All right, as we close.
Thank you. Thank you, Tim. I know it's pretty late in the day. It's already 1 o'clock, and so a lot of you guys want to get going. But thank you, Tim, for praying for clarity, because that is one thing that I think I do have this morning, especially now. I have a ton of clarity. I'm very sad to hear a lot of the things that I heard today, just to be frank and to be honest. A lot of what I heard today makes me really sad, really sad.
Which part?
But I'm excited because...
Then go ahead and just say what part.
No, I'm...
Because that statement doesn't carry anything without...
I'm excited because a group of people here in PYC, your leaders, and I was hoping that this would have came from them, but it didn't. A group of us have decided, and it's funny because we talked a little bit about Pastor Montalvo today. We talked about his passions and his things, but one of them was church planting. One of them was that he had a very strong passion for planting churches. And it seems like that's something that a lot of people want to ignore, the fact that we continue in that legacy and that mission of planting churches. And so one thing that we've decided to do as a group of leaders is to, in fact, do that. And we're going to be planting a church very soon. And I'm not saying this as a recruitment tool or anything like that. I will continue to pray for PYC, and I hope it does succeed, as Tim said. But we will be doing some things away from PYC and independent of conference. And that's why I'm sad to hear the choice of words that were used this morning. But that's okay. And so if the service looked a little bit different this morning, you can speak to me, or you can speak to one of the leaders of PYC that you've known before, and we can perhaps clear some of that up. But I wanted to make it clear, we will be starting a new church. It won't be here at PYC. We will have the same faith. The same faith. We'll believe the same things that PYC does. We will worship the same way that PYC does. We worship the same God. And we will also be remnant.
Amen.
And so that's what we plan to do. And I wanted to just throw that out there And again, if there's more questions even beyond this, then you can see me or one of the leaders and we'll clear some of that stuff up. But I do continue to pray for PYC, and I hope you guys do as well. Thank you guys for coming today, and I pray that you would support PYC and this plan that a lot of these leaders have. God bless.
Thanks, Ben. That's something that I've been asking PYC to do for the last 2 years was to plant a church. Instead of putting a lot of money into a building here that really wouldn't fulfill the mission, you know, grow it to do church planting. But God will bless according to His graces. Amen. I think that let's have just a word, one last word of prayer. I wanted to close on a word of prayer instead of my or someone else's thoughts. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we just ask that Your will be done in our lives. And I want to pray in the name of Jesus that You will bless this church and help it according to Your will. I want to pray that You will oversee and help. I pray for each person involved if a new church plant were to occur. It would be wonderful. It would be within your fold, within Your flock. But if not, we ask for Your will to be done. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, God bless.
Look at me, they look at you. I'm going to get lost. I want to get 6,000.